through the session in 25 minutes so that you will all listen to Dr. Ramanan in detail. The focus in this session, I would straight away go into some few case scenarios which we witnessed, where we had dilemmas and we found some solutions. I'm going to share the data from our hospital KKCTH, and I'm going to finally share the protocol we are following currently in KKCTH. This is a true story. April 2020, this 8-year-old boy came with, had fever, cough, fast breathing. He was hospitalized outside. Dr. Christopher, the pediatrician, did the COVID PCR, and he took an X-ray. It showed the pneumonia on the right side. He appropriately treated with ceftriaxone. On day 4, he got worried about the child. This boy developed redness of the eyes, rash, and he developed hypoxia, and he referred to us. On arrival, he was tachypneic. He had hypoxia. He was hypotensive. We shifted him to ICU for fluid bolus and inotrope support. We didn't know what the diagnosis was at that point of time. COVID-19 had just started in India and in Chennai. And this boy had bulbar conjunctivitis like this. And he had maculopapular rashes like this over the limbs. And he had keelitis, glossitis. And he had pedal edema. And we repeated the X-ray. His fever has not coming down. As you see here, he had consolidation in the mid-zone. At this point of time, he also had a rash like this on the abdomen. We had a problem. We only knew Kawasaki as a diagnosis for this boy. We didn't know whether this was atypical pneumonia. We didn't know whether this was COVID pneumonia where the initial PCR was negative. We also thought of septic shock, COVID pneumonia, toxic shock syndrome, etc. And in the ICU, what we did was hit hard with antibiotics. And at that point of time, we gave IVIG thinking it could be Kawasaki disease. Of course, I made a call to Professor Ramanan and I asked him, some cases are being reported hyperinflammatory syndrome in UK and Europe. Is this that? He said, it's exactly like that. IVIG, we gave the CRP of 400 and odd. And then after giving IVIG, it did come down, that the fever never came down. He didn't improve. We called Dr. Ramanan and we gave tocilizumab, and then it was magic. In 48 hours, this boy completely recovered. And at that point of time, we had a question. Is this KD or is this MISSI? And then if you look at the literature today, there is clarity. There are some differences where MISSI has some findings and KD does not have. What are those? MISSI basically, age is higher, above 5 years most common. GI symptoms are much more common when compared to KD. Myocarditis is more common in MISSI. Cardiac involvement is more common in MISSI. You don't get leukopenia and lymphopenia in Kawasaki, whereas you get it frequently. You get thrombocytosis in Kawasaki, whereas you get thrombocytopenia in MISSI more often. Ferritin is more highly elevated in MISSI. There is a lot of requirement for inotropes, vasopressors, ventilation, ECMO, and biologics in MISSI. You look at the differences in KD. KD, we all know, is a disease of infancy and young children. Respiratory symptoms are highly uncommon. Myocarditis is extremely uncommon. Aneurysms are more common, but not ventricular dysfunction. We all know 10 lakh platelet counts in Kawasaki, not in MISSI. High ferritin, high D-dimer, lymphopenia are extremely rare. And in KD, we give IVIG, most of them respond. We don't resort to steroids and biologics routinely in KD. Rarely does a child with KD go to the ICU. But there are some common features. There is an overlap between MISSI and KD. That's what this boy had. Fever is common. Mucocutaneous lesions are common. Edema is common. Cervical adenopathy is common. Shock can occur. Macrophage activation syndrome can occur. Coronary artery aneurysms can occur. Well, the IVIG and aspirin are common for MISSI as well as KD. And this is the first case of MISSI we reported, first case in Asia itself. Then, originally, it was called hyperinflammatory syndrome. Then it was called PIMS-TS by the Europeans. The Americans deferred, the WHO deferred and called it as MISSI. Whatever definitions are there, you follow one of them. Today we follow WHO guideline. Earlier we followed RCPCH guidelines for uniformity, but all roads lead to Rome. Case 2. This child, 3-year-old, had fever for 4 days, 2 episodes of seizures, rather unusual in febrile seizures. He had encephalopathy. He was normotensive, no focal deficits. We thought it is aseptic meningitis or some meningoencephalitis, viral or bacterial. CT was normal. CSF showed features of aseptic meningitis. Cultures are negative. CRP was very high. ESR was high. Surprisingly, we found the albumin was 2.7. OTPD was normal. X-ray was normal. Ultrasound was normal. At this point of time, does this boy have viral infection or bacterial or rickettsial, metabolic or inflammatory? Whether to give antibiotic or antiviral, we gave both, no response. Subsequently, day 6, conjunctival suffusion, perilimbal sparing, red lips, rash, peripheries are swollen. And then we investigated, everything fitted into MIS-C. At that time, we knew very little about MIS-C. And unfortunately, he had both PCR positivity and serology of IgG and IgM, both positivity. Cultures are negative, echo was normal. This was actually a neurological presentation of MIS-C. We didn't know whether this was acute COVID or MIS-C. We didn't know whether to give IVIG plus or minus steroids. We didn't know whether to give remdesivir. But then, in a given case like this, one must try to differentiate between MIS-C and acute COVID because the treatment might be different. If it is acute COVID, you might give only steroids. If it is MIS-C, you may even consider remdesivir as discussed earlier in the sessions. In MIS-C, your treatment is immunomodulation mainly. So the differences are, in MIS-C, in general, when compared to acute COVID, the counts are higher. If you find 20, 24,000 total count, acute COVID is unlikely. Neutrophilia is very common in MIS-C. Lymphopenia is very characteristic in MIS-C. Hemoglobin is much lower in MIS-C. OTPT elevation is more common in MIS-C rather than in COVID. CRP, we have not seen such high levels of CRP at 200 and 300 in the previous years. In the last 2 years in MIS-C, everything had been more than 100. Ferritin is higher. BCT, unfortunately, which is very says to be very sensitive for infection, bacterial infection, is also higher. LDH is higher. D-dimer, the confusing lab report, is always high in MIS-C. Can MIS-C present with neurological features? Dr. Shobhalan, Dr. Vasanthi published a case series of 3 in which 2 of them presented with febrile seizures, ultimately turned out to have MIS-C. So neurological manifestation may be the only manifestation in addition to fever and high CRP in MIS-C. Case 3. This 7-year-old boy who was previously healthy, he had 5 days of relentless fever, occasional loose stools, he had abdominal pain. On examination, he was toxic, spleen was palpable. Once spleen is palpable, you get a total count of 4,500, eosinophil 0, P72, platelet 2 lakhs, hemoglobin 11, but CRP 60. Somebody had done D-dimer, which was 4,000. Somebody had also done COVID IgG antibodies, it was positive. Liver function, renal function was normal. The question is this MIS-C or our garden variety bacterial infection like enteric? Is it infection at all? How do you distinguish? And what is a broad differential diagnosis for MIS-C? And when do you start thinking of MIS-C? And how would you like to investigate? These are the questions we had. If you look at the differential diagnosis of MIS-C, if you write for a French index of differential diagnosis, almost any infection will come. Almost any disease will come as DD of MIS-C. All tropical fevers, dengue, malaria, enteric fever, scrub typhus, UTI, toxic shock syndrome, very similar to Kawasaki shock, Kawasaki disease, appendicitis, many of them may present with acute abdomen, HLH, MAS, viral infection, they can present with rash and conjunctivitis. Bacterial enteritis, series were reported in Pediatric Infectious Disease Journal recently. Vasculitis, especially SLE and all other conditions. So if you know the DD of MIS-C, you probably know pediatric infectious diseases. Whole lot can present. Case 4. This is a doctor's child where we had problems. This boy who was 5-year-old, had fever for 6 days. He had a rash in this from day three with abdominal pain. He had a background of multiple drug allergies. He was scared because the mother was a dermatologist. He has allergy to cefixime, ceftriaxone. Counts were normal. CRP was 40, OT was 300, PT was 250, bilirubin was mildly elevated, albumin and sodium were normal. He received piperacillin tazobactam elsewhere after blood cultures. He was not better. The mother got a COVID antibody done. It was positive. He got admitted. Repeat labs, CRP went up. CBC, RFT was normal. OTPT were elevated. Albumin was normal. And we did all hepatitis viral markers, septic markers, and typhus and typhoid, etc. We got an ophthal evaluation. Ultrasound was done. Echo was done, thinking it would be KD or MIS-C. And surprisingly, he got admitted. And he became completely afebrile in 24 hours. Dilemma. Should you give this boy IVIG? Should you give this boy steroids on a diagnosis of MIS-C? He fulfills the criteria. And we didn't have alternative diagnosis. We waited for 24 hours. He completely recovered. 2 week echo was normal. And this was a case of spontaneous recovery of MIS-C. Why am I presenting this? Today, as Dhiren said, there's a lot of over-diagnosis as well as under-diagnosis of MIS-C. We are all confused because many a time we see antibody reports, we immediately diagnose MIS-C if there is fever and high CRP. But there is a group of children with MIS-C who have non-life-threatening disease could improve spontaneously. It's always better to admit these children, observe as inpatients rather than try outpatient oral steroids or immunomodulation. In fact, Elizabeth Whittaker, in the first series of PIMS-TS from Europe, she reported that 22% of children with MIS-C recovered with only supportive care. We have also seen quite a few cases. So in children who are not toxic, whose echoes are normal, who are stable, there's no need to hurry through immunologics. Having discussed these four cases, I'm going to share the data from our hospital. After having published the first case, we analyzed around 18 cases from our institution and we published in Indian Pediatrics the first case series. What did we see? All of them had fever. Surprisingly, mucocutaneous lesions were present in 3/4. So if you look at the skin and mucous membrane, you are likely to make an early diagnosis of MIS-C. Serious symptoms with hypotension, palpitation, tachycardia, sweating, autonomic instability, they were present in 2/3. Well, the next most common was GI symptoms and followed by respiratory symptoms. In fact, GI symptoms of appendicitis-like presentation, diarrhea, vomiting, right? Pain. That is very common in 40% of cases. 2/3 of the cases went into ICU. We also saw a few children with acute kidney injury and CNS manifestations. After having seen MIS-C over the last 15 months, our data suggests that we have had 150 cases. Of course, the score is 160 today, but I don't have all the data today. From April 2020 to June 2021, we have had 150 cases. All of them had fever for at least 3 days. Surprisingly, 8% of them were RT-PCR positive. The remaining 92% had IgG positive. We had started doing antibodies right from the beginning. The mean age was 77.2 years. Males were more commonly affected. Kawasaki signs, mucocutaneous signs were seen in 85%. Lymphadenopathy in nearly 1/5. Complete KD phenotype was present in 10%. Incomplete KD phenotype was present in 1/2. In the larger series of 150 cases, GI symptoms were seen nearly in 2/3, 71%. Abdominal pain was present in 50% of cases. Cardiovascular signs and symptoms are present in 57%. Respiratory, mind you, were seen only in 1/8 of 150 cases. So MIS-C children don't present often with cough and cold and respiratory distress. And they can present with all sorts of rashes like this, with bulbar conjunctivitis, hemorrhagic conjunctivitis, facial rash with cervical adenopathy. One child had thrombosis like this, gangrene of the toe and necrosis of the skin. And this child currently in the hospital with urticarial rashes on the feet, on the face and limbs, with features suggestive of MIS-C. Maculopapular or even vesicular rashes we have seen. Coming to the management we gave IVIG and steroids in nearly two-thirds, 71%. IVIG alone in the initial stages we gave 19%. Spontaneous remission had occurred in 5%. Steroids alone were used only in 5%. Biologics including anakinra have been used in 3%. Fortunately, our mortality is zero. 160 cases till now, touch wood, no deaths. 47% cases went into PICU, mean hospital stay was 7 days. Most cases were life-threatening, 54%. Then another dilemma we have, does antibody positivity confirm MIS-C in all fevers more than 3 days? If PCR and antibody tests are negative, does it exclude MIS-C? We started a study on antibodies very early in the month of May 2020, thanks to Professor Ramanan's suggestion. We did antibodies in 463 children, and we found that almost half of the seropositive children had MIS-C or PIMS TS. The figures may be much lower now because of the increased antibody positivity in the community. Then we carried out biomarker profiling of these cases, and we found that almost all the biomarkers, many of them I can't even spell properly, are all much more elevated in MIS-C and COVID-19 rather than in controls. Somebody might be tempted to do IL-6 and D-dimer. Is it required at all? We analyzed the biomarkers in MIS-C and we found that IL-6 is definitely elevated in MIS-C as well as in COVID-19. But then if you ask me, should you do it? There is no need to do it. It should be used only for research tool. CRP is a good surrogate marker of IL-6. We have done IL-6 estimation only as a research tool. Recently, along with collaboration from National Institute of Research in Tuberculosis, we did a study where we showed that children with MIS-C and those who went into ICU had higher levels of CRP and higher levels of alpha-2 macroglobulin and serum amyloid lipopolysaccharide. These may emerge as good markers to differentiate MIS-C from COVID-19. Recently, thanks to the suggestion and initiative of Professor Ramanan, who's going to speak to the audience after me, we published a letter, a correspondence in the Lancet Rheumatology. Why did we do it? Me and Dr. Ramanan have been arguing whether steroids alone can be given for IVIG. We worked out the cost, and we worked out the number of cases which are likely to emerge in India. And we wrote that steroids could be cheap. Steroids are cost effective. We don't have to use IVIG routinely. We also mentioned recovery trial will give the right answers. I'm sure Ramanan will talk about it in his presentation. Having talked about all this, what are we following today in KKCTS? Thanks to Dr. Janani Shankar, Dr. Dhanlakshmi, and Dr. Divya, my registrar. Recently, we, for our own hospital purpose, have formed a protocol. We have used a term called non-life-threatening and life-threatening MIS-C for convenience. What is this non-life-threatening MIS-C? We follow the WHO protocol now for diagnosis. Once shock is absent or once there are no clinical symptoms and signs of end organ dysfunction, we make a diagnosis of MIS-C, we call it non-life-threatening. Once there is shock or end organ dysfunction or any of this as seen in the slide or anything like acute kidney injury also, we call it as life-threatening. We will see why this division is required later. If a child has got non-critical symptoms and signs, we recommend only level 1 workup. And if there is a strong suspicion of MIS-C, we recommend level 2. We'll see later. If MIS-C is not confirmed, we continue to work up for infections. On the other hand, if a child has got critical symptoms, we don't withhold antibiotic. We do give antibiotics after taking culture. We do both level 1 and level 2 tests. And we always do cultures for bacterial infections, viral serology like dengue, scrub typhus, IgM, and clinical judgment when they review with lab reports. The tier 2, this is where cost comes up as a big issue. We do ECG and echo once we think it is missy, and we do proBNP, which is a very sensitive marker of myocardial injury. And of course, we also, as a protocol, we do troponin levels also. We do ferritin for completion, though it is not required routinely. And we do PTT and D-dimer, fibrinogen and LDH for completion, though this may not be useful for regular monitoring, it does not be required in peripheries. Coming to the management, if a child has got life-threatening disease, there is no question at all, you have to hit hard. We do give IVIG, 2 g/kg, over 12 to 24 hours, preferably in 12 hours. And as a protocol in our institution, we have been following 10 mg/kg, not 10 to 30, 10 mg/kg for at least 3 days. And we give aspirin provided the platelet count is more than 80,000 or there is no bleeding. And of course, most cases, I would say 95% of the cases have received empirical antibiotics initially. Once there is a non-life-threatening disease, if the child is not in shock, echo is normal, the child has a non-KD phenotype, what used to be called as febrile inflammatory state, which is not being used anymore in literature, we do consider oral steroids on a select basis, 1 to 2 mg/kg. And if the child has got abdominal pain, we give intravenous methylprednisolone for 2 to 3 days. The child has KD phenotype, particularly below the age of 5 years, we straight away give IVIG and we combine it with IV methylprednisolone. If there is non-life-threatening disease KD phenotype, we prefer to give 1 to 2 mg/kg. We have reduced the dose now for non-life-threatening disease. And of course, we give aspirin. If there is no response after 48 to 72 hours, what do you mean by lack of response? You started treatment, IVIG and steroids. After about 48 to 72 hours, there is persistence of fever, there is persistence of endocrine dysfunction, CNS, hepatic, renal, gastrointestinal, severe abdominal pain, terminal ileitis, the ultrasound. We do consider biologics. And earlier, we used to use tocilizumab. We have used for about 3 cases. Now it's more difficult to get tocilizumab. We have used anakinra in 1 case. We plan to use it if it's available as first line over tocilizumab. If it is a KD phenotype, we consider infliximab. In the last 1 and 15 months, we have not used infliximab even for a single case. All of them have got better with IVIG and steroid. Steroids, after 3 days of methylprednisolone IV, we change out to oral prednisolone and then give low dose methylprednisolone IV if abdominal symptoms continue and taper 25% every week, stop over 3 to 4 weeks. IVIG, we prefer to complete within 12 hours. Most of them tolerate unless they have cardiac failure in the ICU. Slower infusion, only if there is cardiac dysfunction or fluid overload. IVIG dosing is best done as per ideal body weight. We always give standing instructions to the nurses to preserve a serum and a whole blood plasma sample for future studies, immunological studies, viral markers, before starting IVIG. This is a must. And IVIG is not available. There are a few patients who cannot afford IVIG, and now the cost has gone up. Only 5 g are available. Only one brand is available. The parents refuse to go out. In fact, ICH and government hospitals have adequate stocks of IVIG, I'm told. They refuse to go, or if it is not possible in the middle of night to start IVIG, IVMPS alone can be used, but we prefer to obtain parental consent. We explain to them that we are not giving IVIG for such and such a reason. And studies have shown, in fact, in the Bristol Hospital protocol, 70 g is the highest dose of IVIG. We tend to restrict even if the child is obese to 70 g. And over 5 years, we are moving towards steroids alone and avoiding IVIG, particularly in non-KD phenotype. Enoxaparin we have used very rarely, and we follow the recommended guidelines which say that if you have an EZ score of more than 10, or if there is documented thrombosis, or if the ejection fraction is less than 35, we give enoxaparin 1 milligram per kg BD subcutaneously. And prophylactic dose has to be given in consultation with a good hematologist. It's not an easy decision to make. And while discharging the child, what advice should we give? Child is recovered with IVIG or with steroids. We give aspirin unless there is a contraindication for 4 to 6 weeks, maximum of 75 milligram. We recommend echo and follow them up to 2 weeks, 6 weeks, 6 months, and 1 year. An ongoing cardiac follow-up study is on. Anticoagulants, if we had started, we continue with hematology consult and clinical assessment. We always counsel them regarding vaccination after IVIG and high-dose steroid therapy. Of course, the parents should be advised, after a diagnosis of MIS-C, vigorous exercise should be avoided for at least 2 weeks or at least 6 months if there is myocarditis. In the end, I would say MIS-C has been only partly understood by pediatricians, infectious disease experts, rheumatologists, virologists, immunologists, research scientists, pediatric intensivists, and cardiologists. But there are several unanswered questions which should be taken up by youngsters listening to this session. Is there a genetic predisposition? If so, can we predict it before it occurs? We may find answers. What is the immunopathogenesis? You would have all listened to Winsley Rose. There are more questions than answers. That's the status today. Is MIS-C going to remain like KD in children, or is it going to go off from our community next year? Nobody knows. Immunomodulatory therapy. Are we going to fix up the therapy based on the phenotype or based on the severity of illness? Steroids or IVIG or both, or steroids plus IVIG plus biologics or biologics? The answers are not known yet. Long-term sequelae, is it going to be like KD or different? In fact, yesterday there was a report in pediatric recent paper, still not out, which says that 11-month follow-up of these children with MIS-C, the cardiac outcome has been extremely good, but we don't know yet whether it is going to behave the KD way and cause future deaths in young adults due to coronary aneurysms or silent myocardial damage. Vaccination, there is a chance that vaccination could increase the risk of MIS-C. We don't know yet. You would have all seen messenger RNA vaccines causing myocarditis in US. What is going to happen? We don't know in pediatrics yet. I will thank, if I don't thank my colleagues in KKCTH, pediatric consultants, PICU team, microbiologists, pediatric cardiology team, infection control team, and the team from NIRT, particularly Dr. Aishwarya Venkatraman, who had carried out so many research studies, and of course, my close friend, Professor Ramanan, who is on call every day with me for my difficult cases. Thank you for patient listening. Please mail your feedback, negative or positive, to sbsp@gmail.com. Over to Dr. Thangavelu. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Excellent talk. Even though it took us very fast through the, it took us a tour through the MISC. Like when it started in April 2000,